All right, 7 o'clock. Call the Selectmen's meeting for the town of North Canaan on April 7th, 2014, to order. Minutes of the last meeting and the special meeting.
Would they accept it?
I would second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, under public comment, before we start public comment, we need to add a few things. We need to add Mr. Hamlin of the Housatonic Railroad as an agenda item. Grant authorization, sign a grant for the furnace project, electric furnace project. And letters to be signed by me to Senators Murphy concerning expanding the more wheels for trucks. Okay. I need a motion to add those items.
Move it.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, under public comment.
I only have a question. We made some changes to the budget. And they, you know, and we've been informed, and I take it you're going to review them at the finance board meeting on Wednesday? All right.
I assume they are.
I will.
They are going to look at the budget.
Okay.
Now, I think they're going to do it on Wednesday. If not, they'll set a special meeting to do it.
Okay. Because I didn't know if maybe we should meet again to go over some of the changes that we talked about and before their meeting or before the hearing.
What changes?
When we made a few adjustments to the budget.
Yeah. Well,
since we last met.
That's because I took the five.
But if we're going to cover those at the finance board meeting, I'll just come to the finance board meeting.
Well, you had them in your sheet there.
Yeah.
I took them in the I took the five, took it back 5 years.
Yeah.
That's where I came up with those reductions.
Yeah. So
is your proposal down?
It's the same as what it was. It's still up the same amount as what, $83,000.
Okay, thanks.
We're gonna let them know about the dump stickers are on sale too, right? The transfer station,
transfer station tickets. You don't have to tell them, Charlie. They've been coming in.
Transfer station stickers are on sale.
Yeah.
And the cutoff date is May 1st.
How much?
Same price as
last year. Same as last year.
Which is?
$25.
$25.
$10 for seniors.
$10 for seniors.
Okay. Now, we'll move Mr. Hamlin up first.
Okay. Go ahead, Matt.
Okay. Evening. My name is Matt Whitney. I'm counsel for the railroad. And we wanted to come in tonight and give the board a kind of a little information on the progress of the crossing project that's being done here, routes 744 crossings for the especially Minerals Lead as well as the main crossing in town here. We are actually just recently got this set of plans within the last day or so. So if, you know, happy if the board would like to take a look at them.
It's the same project that has been for the last 20 years?
This is the same project,
yeah, but, it's
but it's now,
it's going.
Fortunately, moving. And it's moving quickly. And that's kind of the, it's moving and it's moving quickly, and I guess that is kind of the, is kind of the idea. When I made an inquiry about this a week or so ago, I was told the plans would be available mid-April, and that they would set it up for a meeting mid-May. Obviously, we received the plans early April, and the meeting's been moved up to May 6th. So,
sorry about that.
Thanks to Mr. Senator Chapin.
Yes. Because we wrote a letter as the town, as a petition, and I had over 100 people sign it to move this forward. When I talked to the state the next day after I put the petition in, on Wednesday, they called me Thursday morning, how they kind of had their surveyors out. They do have the federal money to move this project forward, so.
It's the letter that we received up at, if you're interested, it notes the date on the bottom, it notes the date of the meeting.
These plans do not reflect the latest survey data because there's some elevation issues that exist, both for drainage and where the crossing surface is. It's at the bottom of a vertical curve in the roadway, which is a very bad scenario. There are also, I was looking at sidewalk with curb geometry just briefly. I got these plans midday today, and there's some issues about curb geometry, and I have some ideas to improve curb geometry for sidewalk.
For sidewalk, by the pizza place, yeah?
Yep.
That's why we left that.
Yeah.
5-6 years ago, because they were going to do it the next year, so that's why we never did that sidewalk.
And because it kicks out to the travel lane.
Right.
And you can either cut to this, well, I got a picture here.
Does this depict the profile?
Yeah, not well. You can either, I apologize, it's not a great photo, but you kind of have two options. One is to,
we can hold up for you,
take the sidewalk away from the road and cut back along the building, then cross, mm-hmm. or to run sort of a gauntlet track, because you have these switch points. That's a custom switch. It's a weird size. Everything has to be custom made. But extend the switch so you'd have two sets of running rails in the roadway. In the front end of the switch points would be on the other side of the road. That would give you a straight curb line and a decent sidewalk. So that, I'm going to make those suggestions. Vertical elevation, it does have to come up. And that's why we're here, because vertical elevation change impacts the station. And I contacted DOT to see where you are with the station, because there's economies of scale. And if we're here doing work and we do everything, then we aren't paying mobilization, demobilization, and...
Oh no, not common sense.
We try to avoid that.
So now you're talking about two tracks across the road?
Two rails. Yeah.
There's currently no one down here.
But it's not two tracks. What you do is you put one rail about a foot and a half from the other rail. Mm-hmm. And that, I could draw it for you, but it's not two separate crossings. It's just two sets of rails in the crossing surface itself.
Okay.
And that would, it's kind of a weird thing, but there is a gauntlet track in Old Saybrook that goes around the passenger platform, and it's just to give you additional clearance. Mm-hmm. But everything is so condensed and so confined in this area, and there's so many fixed points to find anything that works. It's just a series of compromises. But that sidewalk, as it exists today, is really bad news, and something has to happen to improve it. So, you know, that is one, I think, viable suggestion to really get that curb line back where it needs to be.
And significantly improve the drainage.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Drainage, because this whole thing is everything's wet and underwater. And
yeah, we know.
That's their big concern, is the drainage.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
They took surveys all the way down to the river and everything. I mean, they surveyed extensively.
They've been out here all
so
when
that,
like, here
when,
last week.
When the gates go in there, there's going to be pedestrian gates, too?
Yep. How it's actually designed right now, this is preliminary. They'll take all comments by the 6th. There's two ways you can go. You can have a separate gate mechanism for a pedestrian way, or they call it a back gate.
On the back of the
vehicle. Yeah, which comes off the same stanchion but goes the other way.
If your sidewalk's in the right place.
Yeah.
John, on this part here now, you're proposing is how much, or is how much the state proposing to raise that track? Because I've heard two different stories.
You need to get it up probably 10 inches to a foot. And what that is going to do is improve, well, if I don't have it here, but they did a, well, let me take a look. The problem you have is, they don't have a road profile.
It's not here, it's in Newington. It's a design, it's not a public hearing, we're gonna have it made.
But if you looked at a road profile, basically, these are just plan views. They don't have the profile here. Do you have a pen, Matt?
Sure.
I'll just draw it out.
Here.
And...
I have a paste paper right underneath you there. There's a pen.
If you look at it in a vertical profile, these are the two rails. The road surface is like this. I'm exaggerating. It gives you two problems. You have a planar flow of water down the road surface, which means the water washes all the fine silt, sand, and follows the crossing. Also, what happens is a railroad crossing is a structure, if you think of it like a bridge. And a railroad structure is designed to accept load longitudinally, lengthwise.
Okay, yeah.
When you start putting load on the railroad laterally across it, it begins to wiggle and roll, and that's why we cannot maintain this crossing. And then, when you put it at the bottom of a vertical curve, you're subjecting that to impact loads from the trucks. A bridge approach, you always build a bridge a little higher, and then you just gently come up onto the bridge structure. If you were to build bridges where, you know, you basically drove down into it and impacted it.
Bottom out, right?
Yeah, you damage the structure. The loading goes up considerably. So what we want is a profile, if you had two rails, it would be basically just like this. You want to pitch away from the railroad and then come up a little bit. But you want something pretty gentle. And this wants to be high by probably an inch or two from over here. And that allows stuff to flow away.
Back.
And you don't...
You'd have drainage at those points.
Correct.
Right.
Right. You'd bleed that drainage off. It'd go into the new...
So it'd go this way instead of this way.
Correct. And you aren't pounding it with trucks when it's wet.
In cars and...
Yeah. Then you have a crossing that lasts for 25, 30 years.
Okay.
So that's what needs to happen.
And you're going to tie that drainage into the railroad parking lot because that's the only drainage there.
Yeah, and they're talking...
Tied in and down by the state garage, right?
And that goes all the way down.
Down to the river.
The river.
And I'm not real familiar with these plans, but I haven't looked at them for more than about 10 minutes today. But here it is. Yeah, that's pavement markings. There's
there
elevator.
You go. That's what you were drawing.
Yep. That's what a vertical profile looks like. Mm-hmm. And let's see. Closed range. That's Granite Street. These are two crossings here. Those are elevations. A lot of this is going to change a little bit because they're doing fresh survey work. Let's see.
I don't think you could have changed that much, could you?
Well, they took the project bounds out farther. They're up to the traffic light, and they're farther up. There we go. They're starting to get into it. Okay. This is north this way, so that's the Blackberry, and this is coming down. They're going to run a drainage line all the way down the railroad right away.
What's the length of that?
It's probably about 1,200 feet. Those are elevations.
Well, it dumps in by the state garage now, right?
Yeah. The river, round numbers, the river to Route 7 is roughly 1,200 feet.
Are the utility lines going underneath the crossing for the gates and all? Is that still an issue with the water?
Shouldn't be a problem. And with all the drainage here and dry it out.
Once it's dried, yeah.
Yeah.
It still would be if it wasn't.
Well, you can run power underwater basically with the underground today, but the drier it is, the better it is. Yeah. So.
Well, I'm a DOT resident saying for 20 years that that's why they couldn't put those gates in there.
If there's a will, there's a way. Okay, here's some of the drainage plans. And that should be Granite Ave, and they're running another drain line. And they had to do some right-of-way work and deal with some abutters, and I don't know if they did a land take. Whatever they did, they secured the right to run drainage in another location down.
This is where?
This is going to go toward Blackberry.
Oh, that's
but this is off. This is off Granite Ave.
That's state property there.
Yeah, but there was some conflict about some little piece of private, and they got that all worked out.
Well, actually, it runs on the town's property there.
Okay. But that's what the drainage is going to
be. Yeah, this is one street.
Yeah. Yeah. And we don't expect the drainage is going to change, right?
No.
It's really more of road profile and some a few other
yep.
things. Yeah.
So that's that.
Well, it'll be better.
Right? Yeah. Drainage will be better.
Oh, hell yeah.
And it's been a problem for a long time.
And that's Main Street.
Main Street here. This is the
yeah.
spur here.
Yep. It? So when are they anticipating? This year?
This year?
Yep. Like I said, I only need them for distance.
No, back on this part, back on the other project that we're trying to get through. This money that they're proposing to do this, is that including to lift all these tracks and all that for the 1 point, whatever it is, I heard, through the grapevine for the funding? If they're going to raise these tracks now, right?
Yep.
Right. That would raise this spur in front of the station.
Somewhat. But your grade is coming down, so you run into the grade. So, you know.
So, okay, how much do you think, you know, to where the front is, would it be? Maybe you can see it on that map there.
What's going to affect the crossings? That's why we're here.
Both crossings?
At least one in the front.
So it doesn't go down that much of the spur. You can see it on the main line, but the spur doesn't.
This one. That one's just going to be a pedestrian crossing. What about this one? It'll tie into the existing there? For height, you know,
remains to be seen. We got to settle all this in the meeting. But that's why we need you folks to complete the station agreements and stuff so we can, I mean, there's economies of scale here. If we're here with tampers and everything else, it's easy to do all this work at the same time.
Mine is, you don't know how far they're going to raise this. I'm looking at the other aspect because we have, you know, what you already gave us for a figure is, will the grant money go beyond that to pay for that? That's, I'm only looking at that other aspect. I'm thinking out loud, basically.
What it's going to be is regular runoffs on a railroad is 1 inch per 100 feet, general rule of thumb. So if you raise, the reason I know it's 1,200 feet to the Blackberry River is you have ample room to raise this a foot and still have adequate runoff.
But if this was raised a foot here, this is going to go back farther, wouldn't it be?
But you're coming down a steep grade.
From here?
Right.
You're coming downhill this way.
Oh, that way.
So you
okay.
can raise it this way and still.
Okay, gotcha. So I'm looking at going the opposite way.
Run into the grade.
I'm looking at going the opposite way.
And the other factors at play are the front door to the pizza restaurant down here.
It should be right here, right?
Yeah. I think there's adequate, you know, it may end up being 10 inches. I don't really know at this point because they just did the survey data. Well, they did the survey last week and the week before. So that's not reflected in these plans.
Right.
And they took it for elevations back to this traffic light, and I think they ran over to here. This is in a hole. So when you come up, your runoffs for the road are actually quite short, because you run into those grades on both sides.
Now, where do you measure the grades approximately on the two lines? Like, how, do you know how far back?
No, because they have to determine what this height is, and that will determine how far back.
So they decide what this height is gonna be here, and nor how far this is gonna go back. Is it gonna go back as far as the pedestrian crossing? That's not given yet.
The discussion's been consistently between 9 and 12 inches.
Yeah.
That's...
Yeah, so that's...
But I guess what I'm envisioning is how, if you're gonna raise these tracks, is that, how is that gonna impact your entrance to the depot?
It may only be an inch or two raise here.
By the time you get there?
Yeah. Yeah. Because that 1200...
Well, yeah, you have to grade your parking lot.
They would fix that.
Well, that all gets ripped out, and that's a pedestrian, 6 foot. What's tough for me is having a finished scope. I need a finished scope for the station, which I don't have. And I asked the state and the finished scope. So we need to get the engineering for the station.
Well, we must have it. I mean, I got copies, or Charlie's got copies here in my office of everything.
But I'm just wondering if this is going to change, how much is this going to change? We won't notice. How much is this going to change?
Vertical height, it might be an inch or two.
So it's not going to change a lot.
Even if it did, what he's saying is, under this project, they're going to have to fix that part, right? Am I correct?
Yeah, but...
But not as far as the back entrance, as I'm driving at.
You're not going as far as that back one?
Probably not. But if I have to bring a tamper in...
Might as well do it all at once.
Right. Yeah, I mean, there's a mobilization charge of $7,500 in and out. So if I'm here doing the work...
Well, the other thing is...
It's paid one time.
Two birds, one stone.
Right, absolutely. And
might as well do that parking lot at the same time, because they're going to have to... Now, this is a state project, so you do the railroad work.
Right, under
somebody
force
else
account.
Is going to do the road work, right?
Well, we do a force account for all the railroad work, and there'll be another contractor for drainage, and there'll probably be another contractor for pavement.
So they're going to have to hook up that drainage and do the pavement into that parking lot, because that, under this project, the crossing project, the entrance to that parking lot changes.
Right.
It matches the one...
In the design.
Well, it was already been designed. So now we're going to look at two different projects, not two different projects, but three different contractors, basically, right?
Well, you're going to...
Two, right? Because the state is going to have somebody here to do this work, right? Technically. The drainage?
Yeah, they have to work with us.
And they got to work with somebody...
They got to dig up the parking lot.
Dig the parking lot. Then once the station gets situated, there'll be another contractor doing that.
They might not dig that much on the parking lot. What I'm saying to
you. So a lot of things has got to get ironed out to see what you're going to get done first, or how it's going to work.
And if we can pull this all together by May 6th, we're in good shape.
Well, that's kind of the idea. I mean, the train is rolling, so yeah.
It's happening.
Right.
So what do you need from the engineer at the station then?
We raised some public safety issues and some engineering issues with it. I've only had one preliminary meeting with your engineer. Then I had another meeting scheduled. He never showed up. So I've had probably 30 minutes of input in this whole station project with your engineer. So he is freelancing a lot of issues that aren't necessarily conducive. And change orders are expensive.
All right. So he needs to, Charlie, you're going to...
We've got to get a hold of John Lloyd so we can sit down and...
So that's the engineer, right?
Right, he's
the architect engineer.
He's the slash architect engineer.
And we asked DOT. DOT is going to huddle amongst themselves between the different units and look at this project and see where it needs to be. And I think inform you folks as to what has to be done.
All right.
This is what that Grant, William Grant now is taking over for Don Burgess, who
told
me the exact same thing that you're saying.
Grant, Bill Grant was Burgess's boss, so.
Right.
So it's Bill Grant and the rail people.
So we're waiting on a phone call from Grant, Bill Grant there, William Grant, to set up all this, what we gotta do. Since Burgess took over, Grant, I've only talked to Grant once, and that was through an email, that he was gonna make contact with all the people to be, so we can have a meeting and thrash it out. And that's the last conversation I've had with him.
Yep.
But he must know about this.
He must know about this, I would imagine, now.
He does.
So, it's all coming together, okay?
But there's a number of station issues that are yet unresolved. And for the, it doesn't affect me per se, but it affects my ability to
coordinate stuff or get
things ready. Coordinate, and then it affects you because of economies of scale.
Right.
If I have to go away and come back again.
Doesn't make much sense.
It's a lot more expensive.
Right. Okay.
So.
Well, Charlie, you can.
I'll call John Lloyd tomorrow.
And tell him to get a hold of Mr. Hanley.
Well, just maybe he can come up for a meeting if, you know, if you've got flexible hours or matter.
What he needs to do is he needs to
address the issues, because I remember at that last meeting.
He has to address the issues, and those issues have never been addressed from that meeting.
Okay, yeah, that was.
And they're not that big.
They're not that big.
They're not that big, so we should be able to.
I think the biggest one was the elevations of the track. I think that was the big.
Yeah, but there's egress and from the station itself, property issues. Any one thing isn't that hard, but basically you have a punch list for a project. You check every box, you got a project.
Right.
And I'm just saying you got to check some boxes here.
And if we can do it in a timely manner, we get it all done at once.
Then you got the economies of scale.
John, do you have any idea of this project's cost?
For the grade crossings? I'll guesstimate about $1.5 million, but I don't really know right now. I don't know what's budgeted. And why I'm a little fuzzy is because until they actually determine what crossing equipment, and I don't know what the drainage component is going to cost. And the drainage they're addressing is more than a railroad crossing. It's really a state highway issue, and it's going to be a big improvement for the town.
No, we were, when we stopped the sidewalk.
Yep.
At that time, they were going to do the crossing like the next year.
Yep.
That was 5 years ago. So, they said they were going to do that part of that section of sidewalk by the pizza place. And we told them we'd give them the stones, you know. Rather than do a concrete.
Yep.
I mean, they're set in concrete. That's why they don't pop up.
Yep.
And we'll still do that.
I think they'd be more than agreeable.
Because that goes along with our big streetscape project overall going up.
And if they push the project bounds out a little bit to get the elevations right, that's going to encompass the sidewalks, the curbs, all that other stuff, because you're going to do it comprehensively.
Right.
DOT's not going to leave that stuff hanging. So.
Right.
Now, is the switch involved in this at all, or is that just not an option on that?
We're going to replace the switch, but that's an 18-degree curve, which is extremely sharp. Mm-hmm. It is a number 5.5 switch, which they don't even make. It has to be custom-made. Mm-hmm. So, effectively, the physical points where everything is really can't change.
You're always going to be crossing on the road, or switching on the road, yeah.
Yeah. But with signalized crossing, it'll be faster because you don't have the stop and protects. It's just all around better.
I have a guy in the road.
And, you know, we're running up. I mean, you can see here, too, there's cars on the sidings there. We're getting busier and busier, and we're getting busier in Canaan. I mean, we have a lot of customers in this area, which compared to 30 years ago was really kind of amazing. And
noticeably fewer trucks.
Yeah, and everybody's business is growing, which is really phenomenal. So we have to look for additional siding space or construct additional sightings, and it would be good to get it out of the town and kind of de-emphasize what we do in town. Because as specialty gets busier, we're going to be more of a presence. So for us to get in and out more efficiently without tying traffic up is going to be a big thing.
And what are your options? Because I know you've gotten complaints from people that say, oh, they want to see the cars parked, you know, down the hill from their backyard or things like that.
Complaints follow you around.
Better graffiti. We need better graffiti. More artistic.
So unless you own a whole state yourself, I mean, that's a fact of life. But you try to, you know, minimize it as much as possible.
Now, the acreage you have up on the state line that's designated for a passenger, can you use some of that for siding? Because that's pretty much out of the
way. I could, but realistically, when you look at, I mean, this is interesting because you look at this. Well, I'll give you the short thing. If you look at Wasaic, and most people are familiar with Wasaic, roughly 500 car spaces. The cost for a parking place on surface transportation, or surface parking, is about $3,000 per parking space. And you get about 100 cars per acre. So for a 500-car facility, you need five acres.
Yeah.
And realistically, look, you can see it right there. There's just not the space available. If you go to a parking garage, your cost goes from $3,000 a space to about $18,000 a space for a structure. Mm-hmm. So realistically,
yeah,
it's a problem. And everything is extremely confined in this area. So, you know, we're back to all those fixed points. And there's simply just not enough room for a pretty good facility. And, you know, I'll be honest with you. When you look at a station today and you think of, you know, railroad stations of the past, they're no longer really relevant because, you know, the whole socioeconomic parameters have changed. And basically, people drive their cars to the station, they park. The MBTA just put in, it sounds kind of funny, but they put a purple light in the parking lot. It's tied into the signal system, so when the train's 5 minutes away, the purple light goes off. So everybody waits in their car, they stay warm, they get ample warning time, and they walk to the...
So simple.
So...
You don't need a big enclosure. But you know, when they built these stations like the Union Station, it was horse and wagon.
Or they walked. And you know, the community was condensed around the railroad.
Yeah.
And that's what's changed.
And it feels like our community still is. I mean, everything kind of, this beautiful facility we have down here, everything is kind of, that's kind of the unit point of the town.
Absolutely.
So if we were to put the station, I mean, I think if you, you know, this comes to cross and we have like this beautiful station again with businesses or something to eat or coffee, and we could figure out a way and work together to get more something, you know, the gods give us a gift and we have parking down here, because I know I have three kids.
Yep.
And if I'm going up here and getting in the car, I am not getting out of the car again with car seats. I'm not coming to Canaan. I'm going home. So if there was a way and we could all work together cohesively, like one happy family for the train, for the town, to get access to people to park at this station, have a platform down here, but still utilize this for business.
Absolutely.
In a perfect world, if we could work at it.
Yep.
I mean, I think there's always options and we can always work together. I think that would be a much bigger boom for this little town than going up the road where I get in my car and I'm not getting back out with Toddler. It's not going to happen. So, and I know a lot of young people are using the train coming up from New York and and going, you know, to their summer homes or going up to concerts. But I just feel like if it's not in this area, I mean, we're going to be, I mean,
it's
can we make it much more vibrant? And I think maybe that's something we can discuss down the road.
Sure, but...
What is the issue with the platform type there?
Well, you need high-level platforms.
Yeah.
Number one is it's ADA accessible. Two is that on your travel time with a high-level platform, you don't have the steps on the car, and they're called traps, where the door folds up and you walk down. You got to have step boxes. You got to help people. walk on, walk off. You save approximately 2 minutes on a station stop by having high-level platforms, plus you accommodate...
Yeah,
you accommodate ADA. The other thing you want to do with a station is, in this type of service, you want to be approximately 10 miles apart, so you have some decent travel time, and you can get up to track speed. I was in Massachusetts, it was Congressman Olver's district, and he was the ranking member of the House Transportation Committee, and he was very close to all this, and he was talking about the MBTA and how they had three stops in one town, and the average speed was 27 miles an hour. You can't do that. Yeah, it's convenient, yes, but the whole service suffers, so everything is kind of a give and take.
Can you physically raise that platform at the back of the depot to make it work? Because that was my understanding. It's not going to happen. You've got the building height. You've got...
Could you put one up additionally back here, though? I mean, they have those platforms all the time.
I mean...
Get them out. I mean, we work some magic. Get them out. Businesses, 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 coffee, tea, library. I mean, I'm just putting that in perspective.
You could. I mean, I don't know if the state would like it, but you could wipe out their state garage and turn it into a parking lot.
That's another discussion we could have. Yeah.
We'll relocate the state garage.
Well, what I'm saying, so everybody kind of benefits.
I take your point. Yeah, it's absolutely a valid point. Think of it this way. You got to have about 500 parking places, at least. And effectively, my own guess is, and this is somewhat of a educated guess, is that Canaan becomes a regional kind of stop in character. And you may want to have some secondary stuff, such as a car rental, that's involved.
Yep.
In, so it becomes more...
A bicycle shop?
Shuttle. Pedicab.
And anything you want. And it becomes actually a transportation center more than a train stop.
And we're set up for it at 44.
Well, because your feasibility studies look at, bringing, boosting the economy in the middle of the town. It's not going to happen for Canaan if they're getting off at the state line.
I'm speaking just...
Yeah. Yeah. At private sector, I'm looking at, cost. And, I've funded all this stuff to date and all the studies and everything. And going into it, I said, how do I do this for a reasonable amount of money? And, to build a stop for Canaan on the property that I own, it's probably about $2.5-3 million. If you have to go to a parking garage, you're over $10 million. And that's what throttled me personally.
We'd have to start the space there, but we don't own the land to
if
we wanted to.
Yeah, so
you're not going to find it.
Right. Yeah, I'm agreeable to things, absolutely. But, I'm kind of using the mantra of NASA, cheaper, better, faster. And I think it's legitimate. And one of the problems you can have is you can get too bogged down in grand designs and planning and effectively price yourself right out of the market.
I think people understand that. They don't expect you to do this big capital investment just to help our economic development.
Well,
I mean, a little's good. I mean, it's legitimate. You look at the Downeaster service, and that runs from Boston to Brunswick now.
They extended it, yeah.
Saco, Maine, they're putting $100 million in a mill renovation.
Oh, those are such nice mills up there.
Isn't yeah.
But another thing, we're working to get passenger service reinstated.
Yep.
As a help you, help us, it'd be great. But I feel like if we could work together, you live right over the border there in Sheffield, just make this whole area, it was such a nice little downtown, and it's relatively empty.
Yes.
So to make this whole area kind of boom again, I just feel like it'll be stripped away if it's just park and go up here, when we really just need people to saturate our little snuggly nest downtown with all those nice little windows.
What I would say from observing Canaan for 30 years, 30 plus years now, is parking is a huge issue. Huge, and always has been.
Mm-hmm.
And there, with TOD, that's what real transportation-oriented development, that's really what we're talking about in Canaan. And we had Steve Shepherd from Williams College do our economic benefit study. And Steve said to me after he did all the work, I mean, it was a really kind of a fascinating study. He said, if I was going to invest money, I'd invest in Canaan.
It's a great town.
And that's what he told me, because it has the potential.
We all think so.
I moved here and I have little kids, and I know my counterparts with the Train Campaign have little kids. And, you know, we'd like to see this boom and thrive and be an amazing place for them to grow up and hopefully stay.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So I think passenger service would be one amazing way to do that. And train, station location, definitely.
The other big thing that came out in our marketing study, and I'm off topic here a little bit, but the median age is 35. And, you know, you look at Massachusetts. Massachusetts does a very good job of tracking tourism, tracking visitors. They had 2.5 million visitors. There's a million plus out of New York City. I mean, they have that. Litchfield doesn't have such good data. But you look at the populations, 133,000 in Berkshire County. It's 372, I think, in Litchfield County. The size of the economy. Litchfield County is almost double the size of Berkshire County. Mm-hmm. So there's tremendous gains. But the biggest problem we have, I mean, if you look, there's problems with schools, not enough kids. And, you know, their communities are wrestling with the cost. You go to the venues, the attendance in Tanglewood is down, I think, by 9.4%. And, you know, I'm got white hair and I'm bald. And I mean, you go to Tanglewood, I feel right at home. There has to be an influx of younger people. The train does that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
well, you need new people to sustain the community.
You can't, absolutely, because we're all getting older here, you know?
Well, if we could hop on the train and work in New Milford and just take that ride,
right.
There you go.
That's right.
But more importantly, it's the people coming up to the city with their money.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It's all of that.
Yeah.
But the median age, that's a big deal, 35.
Is that old?
That looks pretty young to me.
Okay, good. You're right. Sounds good.
So I guess back to the crossing.
Yep.
When do you think construction would start? If they said they said, okay, John, we're going to go ahead with this project, when do you think they would actually do it?
Late summer.
Late summer.
That's my
like
guess.
August?
Well, they're going to want to get around leaf season. They're going to want to...
Well, the last 2 weeks of July, as you know,
is railroad days. It's our 50th.
Anniversary. Yeah, you don't want to...
Yeah, you don't want to have it.
Just keep that in mind.
Yeah. Because... Yeah. I just want to prepare people here because what will happen is you're going to do both of those crossings at the same time, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep, one right after the other. But they're going to be in earlier doing the drainage.
That North Elm Street will become Route 7.
Yes. Now, our closures on a crossing, we can do them in 2 days.
Okay.
That's a pretty short one. It's small, so it's not bad. Bigger ones, maybe 3 days. So our outages are relatively small.
So the traffic wouldn't be...
It all depends on what they're going to do for drainage.
But the state
drainage is going to be a bigger impact than us.
But as you know, the state will use North Elm Street
for a detour. Yep.
Okay.
So these are all the things we've got to be thinking about.
It might be something appropriate for the comments. They're accepting comments.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't mess up our railroad days.
Absolutely.
But don't mess up the crossing. You know, just don't say, "Oh, okay, we'll put it off to next year."
No, they wait
till August.
Yeah. August is good. August is good.
I can't keep a crossing in there for more than 2 years if falling apart, and
it has to be done.
I'm in the fall apart mode now again after the third or fourth temporary crossing, which is expensive.
Is that what happened with the derailment on the spur when it cracked?
Yep. Mm-hmm. And it's pumping. I mean, you can after a rain event, you go there and you look, and there's mud pumping up through the grade crossing itself, and there'd be mud in the road. I mean, it's bad.
So, okay. We're set with a time frame. Then you will talk to your counterpart in DOT Rail and tell them that to talk to their counterpart in DOT Traffic, who's going to be talking to Charlie, and that everybody's going to get together so this can go on an orchestrated project. Correct?
For economy wise, yes.
Yeah, but I know
they got to get John Lloyd to get those.
You have things to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And if I can do it, I'd rather do everything at once. It's done. Everything is nice. It's cleaned up. Everything looks beautiful.
Okay.
And it should be cheaper because I'm not starting and stopping. I'm not going right. away for a while and coming back again.
Well, because you're going to be doing that crossing right there and they're going to have to fix that parking lot, you know, we might as well do it all at once and hook up all the drainage at once and be done with it.
Right, yeah,
because you know. They got to cross
you're
underneath the tracks
get
anyways.
Some people
from
upset anyway.
The town parking lot to get to the drainage underneath the tracks to get into the state.
Yeah.
Tie in.
Yep.
We got. We'll just say, too bad. We got to get this done.
Right.
It's 30 right. years overdue.
But the best way to minimize the disturbance, absolutely, yeah. is to do it at once.
All
yeah.
once.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So are we set as far as what we have to do?
Now, shall I have to come to this meeting or just for you guys, though? It doesn't seem for us as the town.
I don't know what they're going to do, but I'm sure you're welcome.
They'll have a town representative there. So
yeah.
Because
yeah.
I haven't gotten a letter yet, you know, like this one.
I right. just got it today,
right. okay.
so.
Because I know when I talked to them, they were going to have a public meeting out here in the middle of May once they got these situated, let the public know.
We had heard that too, which is
okay.
why we wanted to come in beforehand so that you could be prepared.
They must going to have a public hearing. Because
yeah.
they said they had to because we made the mm-hmm. petition. Yeah. The commissioner has to come out from DOT
okay.
highway to
yep.
explain
yep.
to the townsfolks of what's going on.
Yep.
That's not scheduled.
Huh?
That's not scheduled?
Sometime he said the middle of May, he told me.
Yeah.
He said just as soon as they finish surveying, getting the final plans done, they will have everything together. Then they were going to let me know
right.
when they're going to have this.
So that's
when
the
town
about
meeting.
A railroad.
Not a town right. meeting, but the.
Or church and
oh.
Or you can.
I would probably tell them in advance.
Sure.
Sure. Why delay?
Okay.
Right. There's three weekends in July.
Right.
The three middle weekends is railroad days.
Okay. And like I said, it's our big 50th.
Yeah.
50th
mm-hmm.
No, there's
celebration.
There's three weekends. I don't have a calendar.
Changing.
No. Yeah, I was at a meeting Monday night in the Exchange Club.
And
yeah,
you have, Charlie, you have the things that you know what John wants addressed by the architect,
because well,
the engineer.
I don't personally, but John Lloyd has them from that.
He
meeting.
Has a list. He,
well,
has,
he has a list.
He has a list.
He has
a
list.
A list.
Mm-hmm.
DOT, you have to be aware, has a list
right.
of stuff.
And hopefully, you got from Burgess to
well,
William Grant.
I know.
You can always contact me if anybody
yeah.
needs another copy. Of
yeah.
it. We're happy.
Bill
to.
Bill Grant has.
Hope he should
Burgess's
have a list.
File.
Do you have a card?
Should.
I should.
Yeah, Railroad Days is the 12th and the 13th, 19th, 20th, and 26th, 27th. It's three weekends.
It's just weekends.
It's
just
all
weekends.
Weekends.
Nothing during the week.
Nothing during the week.
Weekend. Nothing
yep.
during the
week. So month of July basically is.
Yeah, put you on the spot.
You know, and I always have one too.
Okay.
Use them up.
What governs us on this for a season is the blacktop.
Right.
right.
As long as they're open.
Do it the old fashioned way.
Yep.
Well, maybe this is baby trade for climate change, that we have a very warm fall.
At least for a month or two.
There we go.
Thank you.
Okay, so have we answered all the questions?
Yep.
Yeah. Well set?
Should be.
Thank you, Joe.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for getting the crossing going.
That took care of the railroad station update, too.
Yeah.
Okay.
That took care of
two
railroad
birds,
station
one
update.
Stone. We are efficient.
Basketball
thank
game.
You.
Yeah.
yeah, I know. 9 o'clock. We're on.
Okay.
And he's going to give us his information, okay?
Let's do the...
You can hold on to that.
The letter to Senator Murphy. We're concerned about Senate Bill 747, the previous Congress, which saw increase in semi-truck weights and the size on the roads.
I would...
To all of them.
Right, you got three of them.
There's three letters.
And it's something I can support. We have very narrow roads here, and it's hard for the...
Well, it's not gonna affect the local truck industry. This is for the long haul.
Yeah, but they come through here.
And instead of using trucks, they would...
We'll use rail.
We use rail. How many, was it six trucks? Six trucks? Got it? Six trucks on one rail car?
Four.
Four tracks of trails.
Because you keep about 24 dozen.
Well, four to five, depending on...
Just in Canaan alone, what's it, 167 trucks a day that do not go through the center of Canaan because of...
Oh, yeah.
Wisconsin railroad.
And, well, actually probably more than that because...
Right, depends on whether you're talking about weight or actual containers, right?
Right.
If you looked at our traffic overall, we're replacing 24,000 to 28,000 trucks that aren't on the roads.
Well, I'm in firsthand knowledge of what these large trucks can do to the highway system.
Yes, you are.
I'd say that I would move that we send these letters.
I would second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and the next thing is the furnace, coupley furnace application for a grant. We need authorization to sign it.
I move to authorize.
Provided that they are...
Going to pick up the 20%, right?
They're going to pick up the 20%.
What is it for?
Beckley.
For the Beckley furnace?
It's for renovations. They want to put in, there's a whole letter here.
The building.
They want to install HAVC, upgrading wiring and lighting, restore interior wall in the vault, and restore exterior siding.
Where they stored all the gold.
It's all written. I got it all written.
You know, a study areas to be improved. So it's mostly the building.
The building.
They're looking for $128,000 grant.
From which?
Steep funding.
Yeah. Okay.
And this is being submitted by the Friends of Beckley Burn.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll sign it as soon as you call that guy tomorrow, Dorothy.
Yep.
And just tell him that... We need to have them back with my name spelled correctly. It's spelled correctly on the front page, but not on the back.
Did you see this?
Yeah, I said they... Hyums. They didn't use their...
This is the Homeland Security thing. How many times do we have to do this?
Okay. Oh, they're changing it, yeah.
Okay. Resolved that this is under Homeland Security resolution. Resolved that the name of the governing body may enter into, which would be the First Selectmen, and deliver the State of Connecticut Emergency Services and Public Protection, formerly Department of Emergency Management and Homeland Security, any and all documents which deems necessary and appropriate. Further resolved, the named officer and the title of the officer which is made is authorized and directed to execute, deliver any and all documents on behalf of the named governing body. I know that we've done this, I don't know, five times. Okay, we're not going to read the whole thing. So we need a motion here.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I second that, by the way.
Oh. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Game doesn't start till 9.
I happen to look on my desk. If you look over there on my desk, there's a picture of my granddaughter in a UConn cheerleader outfit. Oh, yeah, she's like 3 years old. She's 16 now.
And they're still winning.
And they're still winning. Can she still fit in that?
I don't think so. Okay, next item. Lost my.
You're back to the top, huh?
Appointment to the animal patrol officer. This is certified to appoint Lauren Marie Foley as the animal control officer for the town of North Canaan, and also appoint Gregory Tidd as the assistant animal control officer, and Jonathan Ruthier as the assistant animal control officer.
Move to appoint.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Health insurance. I've met with Nick and from Rainer and Pierce, and they are investigating on our health insurance to get us prices.
Okay.
So we'll get back to you, or you put it up in your boxes when I get the information back. Got a request from Canaan Child Care Center.
Everybody's fighting over the boss.
The blue boss.
It's one of our best investments.
I would like to use the blue bus. They did last year. And the Canaan Child Care Center would like to use the blue bus. So I told Mrs. Nania that she can work it out with the Child Care Center. I didn't think we had a problem with it, as long as they had certified bus drivers.
Yes. And they have the coverage, so.
Right, they got the insurance.
So I would move that we allow AHA and Camp AHA and the Canaan Child Care Center to use the blue bus with certified bus drivers.
Second that.
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Well, I took care of two birds and one stone there. And we're done with the railroad station. Bridges?
Bridge, I have nothing to report on that.
Signage?
Okay, where we're on the signage.
I called in there.
The Northwest COG is applying for another grant,
state grant
in the amount of $74,000. Jocelyn Ayer is putting that grant through. Canaan is a part of that grant. We can get some signage to match up with some of the other area towns. And as far as I know, everybody who was approached, including North Canaan, has agreed to go forward, and Barbara Henry, the first selectman in the town of Roxbury, is going to be the applicant for the project.
Right.
So that's okay. About that from here.
Mm-hmm. If any documents pertaining to that signage come up, I move that Susie sign
for
the town of North Canaan. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. What's that there? Letter from CRRA. This one lost. In the shuffle.
Yeah. All it's about the rebate?
We got some money back.
What's that? Yeah.
We got some money back.
Yeah. All right.
See, I can put them all in order.
I got mine now. Thank you. CRA Board of Directors recently approved a $10 per ton rebate for all recyclables delivered to its regional recycling facility located in Hartford. And it goes on. Junk mail. So, we still encourage people to recycle.
And it says here, what, North Canaan saved $13,000 in waste disposal fees.
Right. So. Good job. Keep up the good work. Okay, a letter from the building official. I've been told by my doctors not to climb on roofs or ladders anymore. Also, it's difficult for me to get down on my knees and be able to get into crawl spaces. So I think it's time for me to retire from the building official's position. I told you I would give you plenty of notice, so I will stay on until the end of the fiscal year. He told me he may have someone in mind to take over the position, and I'd be glad to help train this person if you wish me to. Many thanks for the opportunity to work for the town of North Canaan and your support over the years. Ernest Sinclair. So, I'll...
Do we need to accept his resignation?
Well, I guess, yeah. Well, no, not right yet, because he didn't resign until July 1. Right. Okay. We should probably advertise.
We should advertise for looking for one.
Building official.
Because the town of Falls Village has already got a letter also, too.
Yeah.
Right.
Because he covers both.
Right.
I gave him a toy catalog today that committed his name. And he couldn't imagine what he was supposed to do with it over the case.
Okay. So, all right, we'll get
I guess we even have somebody that's got to be by July 1.
Right. Planning collaborative update. Oh, that's basically the same as the sign there, but just to mention that Barbara Roxbury was taking on a task, and the last thing was that letter from the Department of Economic and Community Development. We are writing to inform you that a nomination has been submitted to list the subject property on the State Register of Historic Places. That's the Warner Foreign Farmstead. A meeting for the Historic Preservation Council is meeting for a nomination to the State Register of Historic Places.
That's terrific.
Okay. That's all I have.
Okay.
You adjourn?
I can second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.